This program is paid for with a grant from the United States Department of Agriculture, Rural Development, and the members of Prairie Public.
The prairie was settled by people who made their living from the land, hunting buffalo, planting wheat, raising cattle. For generations, the economic base of prairie region communities has been dependent on agriculture. But farm income is depressed. The number of farms has steadily decreased since the 1930s, and there are fewer people making a living farming than at any time in history. That could be a pretty grim picture for our future, but there is good news. Other industries on the horizon hold promise for stabilizing our economy and making our rural communities less dependent on the ups and downs of the agricultural sector. So what's ahead? Will we capitalize on telecommunications advances to become the Silicon Prairie, as some predict? Will we continue to capitalize on our agricultural strengths by processing the crops our farms and ranches produce so abundantly? Will our highly educated workforce make it possible to reinvent ourselves for a high-tech future? Here in the Prairie Public Studio, we brought together some people who have done a lot of thinking about these questions and have some insight into these emerging industries. Scott Stradley, Professor of Economics at the University of North Dakota. Kevin Kramer, Director of the North Dakota Department of Economic Development and Finance. Shannon Bornson, Director of Pride of Dakota, a program of the North Dakota Department of Agriculture. And Justin Chardon, Chief Operating Officer of Sundog Interactive in Fargo. Thank you all for being here. Let's get the first issue on the table, and that is one that got a lot of publicity in the 1980s, maybe get the ball rolling here, and that was the whole Buffalo Commons issue that the people from New York put this theory out about the Buffalo Commons and the North Dakota economy withering away into the prairie. Scott, is this in the cards? Is it happening, and could it happen?
No, that's far too negative of a forecast. Actually, North Dakota is one of the most successful agricultural states on the planet. Sure, we have a lot of negative news that's associated with that success, but the success is that North Dakota agriculture is very efficient. And since it's becoming increasingly efficient, it needs fewer people. That doesn't mean that the prairie is going to become completely depopulated. The state has about 40 million acres of arable land. We're farming nearly all of that arable land to this day, and we'll probably continue to farm that same 40 million acres into the future and continue to produce the variety of goods that we have produced in the past and possibly add some new goods to that product mix.
I know I live briefly next to Lowell, Massachusetts, which was a huge textile producing area in this country, and when that industry moved overseas for the most part, that town completely collapsed, and a lot of other industrial cities as well, but they came back and shifted their economy. I guess I'd be interested to think whether you think that we're just shifting our economy like most economies are shifting in the world right now, especially in the U.S., and whether there's going to be an outflow of or inflow of people to and from this state.
I think that shifting is more likely to occur in a manufacturing or service type of economy. The land that cannot be remanufactured or new land cannot be manufactured, so the world's population increased from 2 billion to 6 billion in the 20th century alone. It's projected to double again by the end of this coming century. There's going to be an even greater number of people per acre on this planet, and I can't imagine how land in this state would ever go out of business.
Just fewer people for it, right?
Yes, yeah, so, the people will continue to fade down to some lower level than we are at right now. Our cities may have to undergo some restructuring as industries come and go, but I think the basic character of the state's economy will not change. In fact, it's very possible that the land could do better at some time in the future once this recession that we're in right now comes to an end.
Mm-hmm. How do you think that recession will come to an end, though, given the fact that more and more parts of the world are learning to do what we do well? Granted, we'll always have the same acres of productive land, and I think one only has to travel to other Great Plains states to see how much better we are at agriculture than some of them. But when you look at the world situation, you know, they're growing wheat in Russia. They didn't used to do that, and they're growing wheat in a lot of other places. And I guess that's what gets into your diversity issue, I guess, if you see all the canola out there, for example. At least we're learning something.
Well, North Dakota has gone through various episodes where export markets change.
Yes.
And as a consequence, we experience surpluses for fairly long periods of time. One example would be when the European Union was created, which was our traditional export market. And of course, the Soviet Union, China, and other nations like the oil nations and the Asian tiger economies came in and replaced Europe as our primary export markets. We're in a period right now where we're seeing some change in export markets. We're also facing a unique and interesting fact that Europe's agricultural policy of subsidizing has made them the number one exporter of wheat in the world. Whether or not we can solve that problem is probably as important to our future as is who we export to. But with world population growing as rapidly as it is, and then the second factor is that per capita income in the world is actually rising.
Mm-hmm.
So food consumption is one of the first things that experiences the effects of that. And I would say again that the prognosis for the acres in North Dakota is tremendous. Now, there will be fewer families working those acres. There are probably going to be much bigger operations in the future than they are today. But those are the kinds of changes that we have to look forward. I don't think we'll ever see our agriculture disappear.
Shannon, what's the Pride of Dakota angle here, and is there a market for your products?
Oh, there's definitely a market for North Dakota products. That's not a problem. Working with our program, most of the companies that we work with are not only looking for a way for them to stay in their community, but also looking for a way to employ others in their community. So our program is really more of a positive twist on, I think, this whole theory of North Dakotans and the out-migration. I guess I am a little bit curious in talking again about some of the other states and their economies. Are you seeing the same trends in a state like California, where, again, a state that's very dependent on agriculture, but also has some of the larger cities like LA and San Francisco? Are they experiencing the same thing that we see here in North Dakota?
Yes, well, the rural areas of the country are all the same in that more machinery and more chemical is doing the labor that was formerly done by people. One thing I think that's different about agriculture in California is there's a little bit better focus and job done in marketing, and especially developing advertising, product identification, like brand names, using the internet as a means of marketing product like the Pride of Dakota has done. These are things that would continue to improve our access to markets. One problem that North Dakotans have always had, I think, is they've not been as interested in marketing. Mm-hmm. They're a lot more interested in production. They've done an excellent job in production, and I think if we do need to reallocate resources, for instance, we need to put a little bit more focus on marketing and see how we can increase the value of our products by selling on the internet and more directly to the consumers rather than to the big wholesalers that often then repackage and then sell in their names.
I think the bottom line is we just have to go with what is going to work now. And I don't think that as much as I love the family farm, and I think it's one of the most wonderful examples of how an economy or family unit and all that stuff can be run. It's a great thing, but it may not be economically viable anymore. And if it isn't, you know, we might as well accept it now instead of later. And I know that's a harsh way to put it, but I think that part of North Dakota's image, and I've talked to a lot of people around the country about this, they see people here as being very competent, very smart, very hardworking, great people, but not but very conservative and not generally up to date on technology and things and just evolution, you know, that they play catch up. And I think that if we want to be out front in terms of how states are looked at in this country, I think it'd be a great move for us to really get out in front of these types of trends.
Kevin, what's the view of ED&F on this? I mean, where are you focusing your efforts right now?
Well, first of all, ED&F does not get involved as a matter of programs specifically in production agriculture. Although I have a lot of thoughts about it and have spent a good deal of time studying it, especially the marketing issue, and I think you've made a good point, Justin, in that a year and a half ago I gave a speech to the North Dakota Newspaper Association where I uttered the very politically incorrect term, we are in a cultural rut, and that this is exactly what I was referring to. We want to draft policy, public policy and investment policy, that's aimed at maintaining the quote family farm the way we've always known it and loved it. And the fact of the matter is the world economy is not going to allow us to do that. The sooner we accept that and start getting to the cutting edge, as Shannon put it, the better off we'll be. And I believe that in there is an opportunity, because I believe that just like the land provides the greatest raw commodity for North Dakota to be the leader in agriculture and food production, the knowledge-based economy is ripe for North Dakota. We have the highest rated students, education system, a higher education infrastructure second to none. Eighth graders are ranked second only to Singapore in science scores, among the leaders in the world in math scores. We have the raw commodity of knowledge and knowledge factories that allows us, I believe, to be a leader in the knowledge-based economy.
And I don't want to take too much time here. Sorry, real quick, I'll add that it's not that we're going from a great system to a system that nobody's going to want to work in. These high-tech jobs are very challenging, high-paying, jobs that people generally really like to do. So I think we're moving in a direction that's going to be positive for everybody as well.
I think we're definitely in a transition right now. If you're talking again specifically about the agriculture community, if you look at the average age of farmers and the study that they did, I believe the average age of a farmer was in the upper 50s. So right now you're looking at a transition where we're going from thinking about just marketing your commodity off your farm, where the people that are coming in and taking over are looking at advantages of how to diversify and also using technology on their operations. So we may kind of be in that lull right now where the ball is rolling, maybe not quite as quickly as in other places, but it is rolling.
And even the family farm is not endangered completely. Certainly they'll change in that they'll own larger numbers of acres and the amount of money that they have invested in machinery will be much larger. But North Dakota has a famous institution it's been able to use in the past to keep its family farms together. And it was, in my opinion, one of the key institutions that helped the manufacturing investment boom of the 1990s, and that's the cooperative. Farmers had good prices and income in the early 1990s. They took that money, invested it, and started a number of cooperatives in the state that are now famous and established, like the Bison Cooperative, for instance, the Pasta Cooperative, the Corn Sweetener Cooperative, are just three examples. And then add value to their own products, create a ready market for their own products, and jobs in our small towns and cities, and opportunities for people that know how to develop the internet to market products. So the state has in its traditions the institutions that it needs to survive. We can keep some of the values that we've had in the past, but we are going to have to give up some of our commitment to tradition and accept change, because technology is what's forcing us to change.
Well, and one of the things along with the cooperative, there are a good many of private corporate value-added agricultural entities that we need to partner with. You mentioned the corn sweetener plant, which had some rough times in the early going as a cooperative, but formed an alliance with a private sector company in Cargill, and now is very successful. The farmers have a market for their product. Cargill has made investment and provides that marketing expertise that is needed. We've had a number of co-ops that have not done well as well. That is the nature of investment. You take some chances. It's why they call it risk capital. Some of them work and some of them don't. And I think through that process, we're getting a lot smarter. We're getting smarter about reviewing markets and doing market analysis and studies and making sure that we have a product that the consumer wants. And that too has transitioned into a more sophisticated, I think, state.
There's an excellent recent article in Wired that I just read, and it makes a point that I guess I've been mulling over for a while, that we are right now on the cusp of three huge scientific revolutions: nanotechnology, the Human Genome Project, and all that means for the future, and the internet. And these things usually come around every 30 years or so, and we're just starting three of them all at once. And the fact that in the last, just a few months ago, within a three-week period, we found out that light can actually go faster than light speed. We found that there might be water on Mars, and we completed the Genome Project, all in a space of 3 weeks. I think that the hallmark and the theme for the next century is going to be those that adapt to change the fastest are going to be the most successful. That's going to be the most important thing. And as a state, that's what we need to do most, I think.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Shannon.
I'm sorry. Wouldn't you agree that one of the problems we have in the state is something that I think has been brought to the forefront by a lot of groups, is just the infrastructure of our state is one of our big barriers right now when we're talking about the technology and information,
right?
Is that we just don't have the right kind of tools right now for everyone to access. And that is something that, like I said, a lot of groups, and Kevin,
yes,
I know,
well,
you guys have
been
working.
As you know, I feel strongly about it and have made some noise about it. And the good news is that we're in the process now of completing that wiring of 550-some institutions and communities in North Dakota with high-speed broadband connectivity, including audio, video, and data connectivity. That's important, first of all, for government. It's important for services, education especially, probably the county services and whatnot, but it's also important to entice private investment, ultimately. And I believe, and I've said this from day one, just as the interstate highway system is, you know, connected us with the country, just as the railroad, as the governor likes to say, was important to moving goods and services in and out of North Dakota and through North Dakota, so, you know, internet does the same into the future. And that's why, as we look at public policy, we have to be aware of the new economy, understand and appreciate and even honor some of our traditions, but realize that if we're going to move forward, we have to make new investments in new technologies and new infrastructures to be part of the new economy.
Mm-hmm. Kevin, I wanted you to touch on a little bit the study that you've undergone on economic performance and industrial structure.
Well,
what is this all about?
And a few years ago, it frustrated me as I watched, frankly, was watching a legislative session that very appropriately responded to the needs in agriculture by providing tax cuts, sales tax cuts, and used farm machinery and farm machinery parts. Very appropriate. It was necessary to help agriculture and hopefully spur on some new investment. At the same time, we became the first state to pass a tax on internet service providers. And I thought, well, now they understand the old economy, but they don't understand the new economy. The good news is Governor Schaefer vetoed the bill, and we were able to sustain that veto. Well, it shouldn't have surprised me, because if you look at a lot of the economic information that we use in North Dakota in drafting public policy, we see that agriculture is 38% of our economy. Federal government is, 30% or so. There's a little bit of manufacturing, a little bit of tourism, and a bit of miscellaneous. What was missing in all that was companies like Justin's Business Services, companies like Cargill's Service Center here in Fargo, U.S. Bank's Service Center, Unisys, Aetna U.S. Healthcare, The Connection, and on and on. And so I set out to get a more objective, what I thought would be a more objective view of North Dakota's economy. We hired Regional Financial Associates, who became the new revenue forecaster for the Office of Management and Budget, to look deep into North Dakota's economy. What has happened historically? And we know that in the last 10 years, 60,000 new jobs, a net gain of 60,000 new jobs have been created in North Dakota. But at the same time, we haven't seen wealth created. We haven't seen, we see that we have 70,000 people, for example, employed today in declining industries. That's the bad news. The good news is we see about 100,000 people employed in growing and dynamic industries. The vast majority of our people, or a plurality anyway, are employed in stable industries. Mm-hmm. It's important that we know what all of those industries are. How does public policy enhance the growing and dynamic industries? And what can we do in education, higher education, infrastructure development, investment, to make sure that our investors and our companies and our government are responding appropriately to the new and dynamic economy that's going on nationally and globally? So we've taken a pretty harsh and critical look, and we've seen both good news and challenges. And I believe the challenges provide the opportunities.
So was the service industry what topped your list of the dynamic industries then?
It's by far the largest. I think about 35% of the growing and dynamic industries are in the business services sector. But what I need to see, what I think we need to do, Shannon, is as we look at business services, as we look at information technology companies like Justin's, we look at entrepreneurship, and I look back to the college campuses, I believe one of the voids that we have in North Dakota is we haven't taken that tremendous entrepreneurial spirit that exists in agriculture, where people have bet it all and do it on a regular basis, and translated it into other industries. And we have incredible research going on our campuses. We have incredible scientists, engineering, polymers and coatings, the business colleges, and doing a lot of research. But somehow we need to translate all that brain power into a marketable product. That's just one example that I see as opportunistic in the new economy.
I think a tradition that's held North Dakota up to a degree is its lack of understanding, and to a degree a distrust of corporations.
Yes.
And you mentioned that a minute ago, how the corn sweetener cooperative owners were willing to approach Cargill, which is not a publicly traded corporation, but is the same as if it were one,
right,
in terms of its size, and ask them to partner and make the business a better business. This is unique, really, in the state's history, and there's a lot more potential for this. And as far as entrepreneuring is concerned, we need to educate young people that today, when you start a business, you go to the Secretary of State, apply for a corporate charter, you get the right to issue so many shares then of common stock, and that's where you make your money. is once you get your company up and running, that stock has a much greater value, and you can do that from this state now, whereas before you were more likely to have to move to an urban area. Of course, another problem that we have that's related to this is venture capital, investment capital. And this is, I think, often why our entrepreneurs have had to leave the state. We need to make people more aware of how important it is and how also they can contribute to the state as a whole if they were to consider investing in North Dakota companies. That's not just the bank's responsibility. That really boils down to the pension funds. It boils down to every householder and every enterprise in the state could do something for economic development in North Dakota by considering some of these new corporations, for instance, like Justin started. And when he goes public, which I don't know if he has yet or not, public, he's going to want money to be able to expand his business. And we don't want to have to send him to the Twin Cities to do that. He should be able to do that here.
That's a problem. I mean, and right now there isn't very much venture capital in the state, and it's like the rest of the state, it is conservative. And we have looked in the past, and it's been a little harder to find than we would like. And there isn't quite as much understanding in the banking industry of what high-tech companies, for instance, need. So I agree.
At the same time, you know, it's interesting when we go to a venture capital company, and oftentimes we will try to help companies do that. And you're right, there's not very much venture capital in North Dakota. We'd rather invest in something we know than something that's a good investment. But you take a company like Justin's out of state to a venture capital club, say in Denver or Minneapolis, those folks see, you know, hundreds and hundreds of business plans in a week or a month, and it's very hard to get their attention. And then they might respond favorably to one in 100, and how do you get to the top of that heap? And that it really is a challenge that we have to address, I believe, in this state, somewhat with some capital that's considered, we call it patient or benevolent capital, that requires some public backing, but at the same time educating people, private citizens in North Dakota, with their pension funds or with their retirement dollars or with their own personal dollars. In some way, we have to find a way to mitigate some of that risk, to make them feel a little safer about making some of that investment. And it's a pretty high priority right now, frankly, in economic development in North Dakota.
We are getting short on time, so I want to ask each of you for about a 30-second response. Start with you, Scott. And the question for all of you is, if you had one piece of advice for a community to ensure its economic future, what would it be? Scott?
I think that piece of advice would be to invest in your children. There is a risk that they will leave the state. The majority of them probably have in the past, but one person that stays behind can create so many jobs that it is an investment, a cost that we incur that can yield benefits not only to individual stockholders but to the whole community in terms of giving it not just a future but a growing, vibrant future.
Okay, Kevin?
You know what I think, this is probably aimed mainly at the rural communities, and that is to don't be afraid to aggregate your resources into a region. And I talk a lot about regionalization. You're doing a special on Class B basketball in North Dakota, a series, and that's exciting to see. But somehow we got to get over the fact that we lost that game last year to the neighbor and realize that when it comes to our economy, we need to be friends, because as companies look for available workforce and infrastructure and resources of money and other things, together it works better than if we try to split the pie in too many ways. So I guess my main advice would be don't be afraid to cooperate with your neighbors.
Okay, Shannon?
My advice would be right along those same lines, Kevin. It seems with some of the small businesses that people might have a good idea, but they're scared to either talk about that idea or to go to other people for help. And it's the way to go, is to start talking to your government agencies, talking to people in your community, and you never know who you can find a resource. You're not a failure if you need to ask for help. You're only a failure if you don't try something.
And Justin?
I agree wholeheartedly with Shannon, Scott, and Kevin, but I guess I'd go back to my previous point that everything in the world is changing drastically, and the only two choices we have are whether to accept it or to hide in a shell, and there's a lot of both sentiments in this state right now. And if we hide in a shell, it's all over, basically. I mean, we'll still go on, but we will not be a part of this new economy, and I think that we need to accept what's changing and try to make the best of it and try to take advantage of the change, see it as an opportunity to make North Dakota look more attractive to people from the outside.
Well, I want to thank all of you for coming. You've been an excellent discussion group, and thanks to each and every one of you. Changes in technology, communications, and transportation are remapping the economic landscape of the prairie. No one is sure what the future holds, but it's clear there are some exciting times ahead of us. If you'd like to learn more about the changing face of agriculture and what emerging industries are in our future, visit our website at www.prairiepublic.org.
This program is paid for with a grant from the United States Department of Agriculture, Rural Development, and the members of Prairie Public.